tell you how fabulous it was.
All right. Okay, so we are rolling. And Phyllis, what fun, because you were just here for Bob Hope's 80th birthday.
Yes.
And now I get to welcome you back again.
In just a few days, I'm back home where I love it.
And fresh from a hit engagement in San Antonio.
Yes, San Antonio is sort of a new town for me because, you know, I've...
You know, I'm sitting here down my...
Isn't that something?
I thought I felt undressed.
But you were. Isn't it funny? I didn't even
Okay, we're rolling again.
Okay.
Well, Phyllis, welcome back to Fort Worth. Let's see, just a week or so ago, you were here for Bob Hope's birthday.
Yes, to restore Thistle Hill.
And then you ran off to San Antonio.
Yes, for just one gorgeous week. It was so much fun. I couldn't tell you how much fun it was.
It was a special thing for you?
Yes, it was at the Fiesta Dinner Playhouse there, and they had never had anything but a book show. So it was a lot of fun to romp in there and do my kind of thing.
And to be the first one, and they must have just ate it up.
They did. It was really wonderful.
That's great. You know, Phyllis, we've done so many interviews, and it's always a challenge to me to find something that we haven't talked about before. But you know, there's one thing that I have several times meant to ask you and discuss with you a little bit, and haven't gotten around to it, so this is the time. You were one of the first, if not the first, stand-up woman comic, right?
I believe I was the first.
The first.
The first. Okay. There weren't any.
So you did that, you were a big hit, you got the ball rolling for all of the women to come after you. Now, I wonder, in the very beginning, when the public was not yet used to women stand-up comics, was there ever a kind of thing in you that you were kind of ashamed of telling people what you did?
Oh no, never. Never. Because if I had been ashamed, I would never have made it. You can't get anywhere being ashamed. I was proud of it always. But I did feel some sort of adverse reaction to being a woman comic. Naturally I would, because I was the only one and it was very new and no one was accustomed to that. In fact, today, you know, there are only two of us that are comics, Joan Rivers and myself. There are comic actresses, that would be Lucy Ball and Carol Burnett, and then there are comedians, Carol Channing. But you see, comic is, that's the stand-up part. And that's the hard part, it really is. I admire those women so much, you know, the women who do work sketches and in movies and shows and plays. But you see, Joan and I are responsible for our own material. Now that's the difference, you see.
Yes, and
and we work alone, that's the other difference. Scary difference. You can't blame anyone.
But now, of course, surely the public is much more receptive, aren't they, to
women?
Oh,
well, it's, I'm pre-advertised and pre-sold, and they accept me. You know, you walk out and they laugh. Of course, I walk out looking pretty funny. On purpose.
The get-ups, was that always part of the routine?
Oh no, that grew. When I first started out, I dressed just like the woman next door, which is what I was. And it was just a normal looking old girl, and I didn't know anything about show biz. And then as we went on, I got more and more and more. And then as the rooms got larger, when I started playing bigger rooms, I had to come on. You have to sparkle, you have to be bright, they have to be able to find you. I started out wearing black. I looked like I was on my way to a funeral.
And today, how many different wild outfits do you have?
Oh, Bobby, you've got to visit me someday and try them all on. It will give you so many laughs. I have a whole room full of wild outfits. One whole room full.
And you just keep adding to them?
Yes.
Recycling them?
Yes, just keep. The ones I'm wearing here were made in Australia. By a person who designed a show, a television show over there. And I found that he was just out of his mind. So I hired him, of course.
Do you envision, as you go on, Phyllis, that there will be another change in your professional life of some kind? Now, you've done book shows. We know that.
True.
You've done Broadway.
True.
Do you envision that there will be some other change from what you're doing now?
Well, I don't know. I just take it as it comes. I work whenever I can and wherever I am invited. And I'm so happy doing what I'm doing, where I'm doing it. If a Broadway show should come up, I might take it. I might do that. Or if a suitable movie came along, but that's a rare rarity, because most people who do movies now simply produce their own. You have to find your own properties and either write them yourself or find them. And I haven't taken the time or done that kind of work because I'm having such a ball, you know, just having fun.
As a kid, were you a funny kid?
I must have been, because I always got that part in the school play. They always gave me the funny role. So I must have been. I was completely unaware that I was a funny kid. I was strange, probably, because of my parenthood. My parents were very old, and they were very strict. And I was brought up by two old people, all alone. I was an only child. And I developed a fantastic imagination because I was alone so much and didn't really have that many playmates.
Did you have those imaginary playmates?
Oh, yes. Oh, my goodness. I had cats who were my children, and I put clothes on them. And then I had nine dolls who were my definite children. And in fact, it was so subconscious in me that I patterned my life after that. I wanted nine children. And of course, I stopped at five because they kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. I mean, the last one was 10 pounds, and I could hardly move because I didn't weigh much more than that. I gave up on that. But my dolls were very real to me, and I talked to them. One doll, Josephine, my favorite. I cut her hair so many times, I had to change her name to John. I just loved to cut her hair. And this was in the old days. I even had a boy doll. His name was Murphy. I loved them with a passion.
And did you do funny skits with him, or you just took care of them?
No, I really mothered them. I was a very good mother. I took them for walks in the buggy. Oh, by the way, I was married. I was a married woman when I was 6 years old. This little boy who was a neighbor, Franklin Steiner, and his father was a doctor, and my mother on the extension picked up the phone one day and heard me say, "This is Mrs. Steiner." And because I forced him to air the children with me. We walked around the block, and I had him in tow. I tell you the truth, I was the dominant person in that first marriage at six, and in both of my marriages, I have been dominant. And I'm not really proud of that. I'm just such a dominant person. There's always, you know, a dominant and a person who is a subordinate, I suppose. I don't know whether that's the word or not.
Well, it doesn't necessarily have to be a bad thing.
No, I guess not. I can't help the way I am.
You know, it's some people take charge.
Well, I do that because I want things to run well.
Phyllis, as always, I could sit here and laugh and chat and talk with you. But you have a show to do, and we don't want to intrude on any more of your time. But it's been wonderful to see you, especially twice in the same month.
Well, Bobby, you know, it's always a pleasure to talk to you, and you always know what to say.
Thank you. Funny.
I had forgotten all about my first husband, Franklin Steiner. It was a wonderful life.
Doesn't matter what's happening here. I might just have you listening a little bit in case we need that. And so anyway, I have to tell you that somebody, and I'm got his name and number and everything, took some wonderful pictures of Bob Hope's birthday. And if you would like some, I will get some for you. I mean, I'll take care of it. But I mean, if you would like, I'll get your mailing address and send some to you. And great pictures of one of Dolores singing and Bob in the back.
And I'm so excited about that.
Oh!
He's really the nicest guy I have ever had a shot at. Rendezvous all over the world, because you know I go every place and he goes every place. And so it works out very well. Because he's not tied up, you see. It is a darling thing that's going on, you know? Who knows? I mean, I couldn't predict. I could never predict. It's But I'm just enjoying it.
Oh, that's
for what it is. It couldn't be nicer. We did a cruise together. Oh, we went to England together, London. And we spent 4 days on the Shokoff Ranch.
Oh.
I go to New York so much. And
visits me in California. Heaven and earth. At my age, Bobby thinks, imagine.
It's wonderful.
At 65, wonderful. To have a real beau.
It's wonderful.
It's nice.
Okay, why don't I do a question? When you started, did you wear the funny get-ups? Was there ever a time when you first started that you were ashamed to tell people you were a stand-up comic? Were you a funny kid? What do you remember about your childhood that amuses you now? What is it about your childhood that amuses you now when you think about it?
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to talk to Jim a minute. And then pretty soon, I see that he has been removed and that I can go back and make a change. But I got to talk to Jim a minute. And since we're out here, I missed rehearsal today. And I didn't get a chance to rehearse the band on their part as my new deacons for the Reverend Leroy thing. I didn't get a chance to rehearse you guys today, did I? And there are a lot of Reverend Leroy fans here, and there's a possibility we may do some Reverend Leroy. So I'm going to talk to Jim a minute. You guys contemplate. Then I'll come back and we'll rehearse that. And once we get that down, then I can go change and we can start the show. Really? Then we officially get the show on the way, because this does not represent a part of my show. My audience deserves more than this. But I want to talk to Jim a minute. Jim, do you own a dog? What kind of dog? Mutt? Yeah, they're hard to find, you know, Jim? Maybe I should just go start rehearsing it every night. No, Jim, Wawa killed a Great Dane. I said he got stuck in his throat. We're gonna jam the door. Jim, I want to be sure I bring that. I like those animal stories. Hey, Jim, I got another one. You have any kids, Jim? Huh? Little boy? Hey. That's the guy in the story. Was out walking his father, was out walking with his son. And they see two dogs there mating, and the kid says, Daddy, what are they doing? And his father said, they're making a puppy. The kid said, oh. And that night, they put the kid in the bed, and they thought the kid was asleep, but the kid wasn't. You know what I mean, Jim? And the kid comes down the hall, and he pushed the bedroom door open, and mom and dad are in the room.